Tonight on Need to Know, his is a legacy unlike any other. How famed writer, orator, and abolitionist Frederick Douglass continues to impact our society. And why a community is working together to ensure that legacy lives on. That's next. Also on the show, a story of adversity, resilience, and beating the odds. A recent high school graduate and filmmaker explains what it means to take the long way home. Don't go anywhere. These stories and more are coming up right now on Need to Know. The indomitable Frederick Douglass. That's what's happening right now in our community in commemoration of the famed abolitionist's bicentennial. 200 years after his birth, the work done by Douglass in Rochester, both the famous and the lesser known, remains relevant. Reminders from Douglass that it is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men continue to challenge us in our schools, churches, and households. Celebrating this living legacy is part of a year-long community-wide project which involves public art, exhibitions, and reflections of Douglass. Joining me in the studio to share more is Carvin Eisen, project director for Re-Energizing the Legacy of Frederick Douglass, and Olivia Kim, sculpture artist for a series of life-size statues of Douglass being installed later this month. And welcome to both of you. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Considering our nation just celebrated the 4th of July, I have to mention the fact that it was here in Rochester, as many people do know, that Douglass delivered his famous July 4th speech in 1852, asking, "What to the American slave is your 4th of July?" And he later went on to say, "There is not a nation on the earth guilty of practices more shocking and bloody than are the people of the United States at this very hour." How does that speech still resonate today, Carvin?
Well, it resonates significantly today. And first of all, I want to thank you for having both of us here. And your focus on Frederick Douglass is so critically important. That address, which was delivered at Corinthian Hall that you spoke about, is as important today as it ever was in American history. And I'll give you one reason why. Frederick Douglass worked all of his life as an abolitionist, an orator, activist to bring parity, to bring focus on the lives of African American people, and all people really, but particularly African American people. And one of the things that he railed against was the fact that the structure of society would allow the government, landowners, people who held slaves to take their children away from them, to take babies away from mothers. Cut 150 years later, what is the United States government doing on the border of Texas and Mexico? Taking babies away from their mothers, separating families, doing the very same thing that was done in slavery more than 400 years ago. So that's why it's important. It's important to draw attention to those issues. It's important to for us to recognize that while things are better, and I cannot sit here and say to you that things are not significantly better, but there is still work to do. And that's why we started this project, so that we could work on and address the legacy issues, which I think are important. There's no question the legacy of Frederick Douglass and the historical issues, where he walked when he was here in Rochester, where he lived, who he knew, you know, the things that got accomplished, but also beginning with the question that you ask, what does Frederick Douglass mean today? Yeah. And that we really want to focus on.
will that work in terms of ensuring that this legacy lives on, includes you with this community-wide project? So I want to talk a little bit about this, Olivia. You are installing and have created a number of sculptures, life-size sculptures of Frederick Douglass. And I want to know first, there will be an unveiling of the installations on July 19th. Talk a little bit about what you first thought when this idea, this opportunity rather, presented itself to you to be involved in such a way.
Well, I think what really interested me was that this project is a remaking of the original monument that exists on at Highland Bowl. I'm not sure if it's transferred yet, but will be transferred to a more prominent location. So this is a life-size version of the original bronze monument. And I think what really interested me was that the hands of Douglass's living relative are going to be incorporated in this sculpture. So for myself, I found it quite interesting to see how there are even similarities in the bone structure, and you know, you just have to wonder what parts of that of Ken Morrison, he is the living descendant of Douglass.
So this is the great, let me make sure I get all of them in there, grandson of Frederick Douglass, and these are actually his hands that you're using.
Yeah, so what really interested me was how, as a human being, how does he physically carry on the characteristics that were, you know, that existed in Douglass and lived on? And I actually saw similarities in the facial structure. It was bizarre. There's a certain expression in the nose and the mouth area that was exactly the same. So I really do wonder how thought patterns, emotions, feelings, depth of feeling can be passed down through generations. So that was quite interesting for me.
I want to talk a little about the significance of these life-size statues. Talk about that, Carbon. Why did the committee working on the Douglass Bicentennial say these replicas need to be made?
Well, our community has a long history of public art sculpture. We saw the horses on parade. Yeah. We saw the benches. Some of them are still around. We saw golf balls and many other attempts to bring, quote, art to the public square. So when we were talking in the winter of 2017, one of the ideas that came up, and it seemed logical to me, what if we were to take Stanley Edwards Monument, which Olivia has, I can't say enough about what this woman has done with this monument. This is gonna blow people away. It is as if it will move off that platform and engage you. So it was our idea that what if we did that? What if we created a replica that actually has its own attributes, because no matter, even though Ken's hands are involved and Olivia went all the way there to make sure that we had something that was just remarkable. What if we put that on the street and people had a chance to interact with it, right? Because each monument will have a QR code, which will be able, you will take your cell phone and be able to pull up information on a website that tells you specifically why this monument is in the location that it's in.
I want to just to interrupt for just a moment. I think it's so significant in terms of using these statues as well, given if we look at our political climate and what's happening around the country when it comes to statues of significance, and we're hearing about them in the South in particular, the decision to do this as a way to build bridges.
This is really important, because one of the things that we like to say is that in cities around the country, such as Charlottesville and other communities, not just in the South, across the country, where Confederate monuments are serving to break communities apart, to polarize communities and reinforce difference, our monument, created by Stanley Edwards, has always served to bring this community together. And that happened this year as well. So it's our thinking that let's just take that one step further in this year of Douglass. Let's take it right straight to the community and very possibly around the country, because we're working on an initiative that may get monuments in other communities as well.
Wonderful.
So
So we're talking about 13 sculptures that will be installed throughout Rochester. Am I right on the number there? Okay. All of them placed in locations of historical significance to Douglass. So you mentioned, you know, one will be at Corinthian Street and State Street. Where else will they be located?
Well, they'll be in many locations that were significant to Frederick Douglass's life. For example, and I can't tell you all of them off the top of my head. It's all written down, and your viewers will be able to, to find them. But there are places that are significant. For example, where the North Star was published originally. That is very, very important to underscore that and to draw attention to the fact that a newspaper of such magnitude published by a person who was formerly enslaved. And it's important to say it that way. He was not a slave, he was enslaved. So there will be a location there. There'll be a location at the corner of Main or Alexander and East Avenue where there was significant activity in his life as well. There will be one at the Mount Hope Cemetery in the entrance. Right. So all of these locations are significant. They create a real interesting opportunity for tourism and development because people will want to take the tour to see all 13 of them or however many it turns out
and
to be.
And I will share that site before we close. I want to pull you in because, Olivia, in terms of reading about you, I understand you specialize in body movement when it comes to sculpture work. And you've said the emotional and psychological constitution of an individual is directly linked to their movement vocabulary. So I want to note what that means and if that all informed, even though you're doing a replica, did that all inform the work that you did with these sculptures?
Oh, absolutely.
Talk about that.
Absolutely. The past 10 years I've studied body movement all across the board, biomechanically, the kinesthetic quality of movement. I did physical training as well. Essentially, if you can change the way you move, even in one part of your body, let's say your shoulders, right? You change the range of movement in your shoulders, right? You can start to alter and free up even thoughts or feelings that are trapped in that part of their body, and you'll start to notice changes in yourself. I know from personal experience, I'm not just, you know. And what I found was that when it even comes to a replica of a sculpture, it is not enough to think that you can just copy something. We are so intricately made. The way we perceive things, the way we perceive other people, most of the time is affected by ourselves, how we are made. So even if you see someone else, that doesn't necessarily mean that you see them for what they really are. So when it came to capturing the body language of this sculpture, I admit, I put a slight little tweak to give it a slightly more of a contemporary feel, more of a feel that applies to where we're at today. Because the time when Frederick Douglass's monument was made was right after he passed away. And at that time, slavery had only just freshly ended, right? So in comparison to now. So in a way, a call to compassion for today, I felt was the message that I wanted to put through his body language.
We have to close for now, but I do want people, our viewers, to please save the date. It is Thursday, July 19th. That is when there will be a mobile-friendly website. That website is douglasstour.com. It goes live on that date, not before then. So the 19th is the first day when you can take a self-guided walking or driving tour of the statues, get biographical information about Douglass, and excerpts from his speeches. Now, there is also a marathon reading taking place on July 19th of the autobiography, Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, an American Slave, that is open to the entire community. And the first reading is taking place at noon at the Harold Hacker Hall at the Central Library. Well, it is not every day that you hear a story similar to that of PR Mo. The young woman was born in a refugee camp in Thailand. At the age of 12, she was forced to flee her homeland with her family due to an ongoing civil war. Fast forward 7 years, she's now the salutatorian of her graduating class and a filmmaker who documented her story of adversity and resilience in a film screening this summer at the Rochester Teen Film Festival. Joining me now to talk about her film, The Long Way Home, her story, and the work to support students facing insurmountable obstacles is PR Mo, 2018 salutatorian of Edison Technical and Career High School, also filmmaker and soon-to-be freshman at RIT. I hope I'm right about that. Yes. NPR is joined by her digital media teacher and mentor at Edison Tech, Laura Barstow. Thank you both so much for being here. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having
us. That's great.
PR, it is not always easy for people to share their story for a variety of reasons. So I want to know, why was it important for you to be able to share your journey with others through your film, Long Way Home?
I feel that it is important to share my story because most people in my community, it's hard for them to share their story because of the past. Sometimes they wanted to share their story, but they feel like people are not listening, or they feel that it's hard for them because of the past. You know, their past. They were being. You know, violence, like they by the military soldier. So they had these experience in the past that stopped them from telling their stories.
What, that being said, talk to me just a little bit. I want people to hear your story. They'll be able to see your film, and we're going to push that to make sure that they do. They're seeing some of the footage from the film as you were speaking. Talk to me about the aspects of your journey that you found really important to share. What were some parts of your story that you wanted to make sure others knew about?
Yeah, I wanted to share my story of how our Karenni people used to have independent states, and because of the civil war, it ruined all the Karenni people life and also other ethnic groups. And the important thing is that young people in refugee camps wanted a better education, and they many of them couldn't have the education that we have like here in America. And I also wanted to share my story because our people suffering from this long ongoing civil war. It's known as the longest civil war in the world, and it's happening for more than 6 decades. And I wanted to share my story so that to help other people to inspire them to also tell their story, to take action to help, you know, the history to stop repeating.
I read somewhere that you said that part of the reason that you wanted to share your story in this film was to make sure that your people had a voice. This was a way to give them a voice, and I think that's an incredible way to do something like this.
Yes, because back then they don't have a voice. Like in Burma, they had a totalitarian government where the leader have control of everything, so we didn't have a voice to tell other people how what's going on. And my parents, when they were young, they didn't have a chance to education, so because of the war, and these also stopped them from reaching out to the world and tell them what's going on, and all these killings. Okay. Not many people hear about these stuff.
Well, the process of detailing your story and sharing it in this documentary film, in a documentary film format, I should say, took place in your digital media class. That Laura, that you are the teacher of at Edison Tech. What was the assignment? I'm curious, was it an assignment to share a part of yourself? Talk a little bit about that.
So students within DMAC, in my pathway in particular for video and television production, have an opportunity at the end of 3 years of study to put together a documentary. And it's part of their senior project that they need to do in order to get their certification through the program. And so we kind of hash out amongst you know, ourselves, you know, what kind of story they want to tell. You know, what is it that they really is, you know, something of a passion to them. And they may choose anything from what they want to study in college. So maybe it's obstetrics and maybe it's something about that, you know, and how can they follow that story? Well, in talking to PR, it's, you know, I mean, she had the story to tell. I mean, it was right there. You know, and one thing that she came to, well, what am I going to do for my project? And you'd think, well, obviously, you know, I mean, we're sitting here going,
right.
Yeah. That's not a hard one, you know, to come up with. But as we started talking about it, and now I understand that I've had her for 2 years. I first met her at another school I was at when she was in
Douglas.
7th grade, 8th grade, something like that.
Yes.
So she actually had come into my room, and she wasn't a student I had, but we kind of just talked back then. And then here she ends up at Edison, and there I am. And so she joined the program. So when we were hashing out the story, it was kind of, you know, amazing to me that she had reached the point in her life that she had. When you hear about, you know, she could have died as an infant, you know, the struggles that her family had to actually come to our country, you know, it was time for her to tell her story and for us to know about it. I mean, I didn't even know about it. I mean, you're talking 60 years, she's telling me this, I start reading about it, and I'm just in awe of the fact that we don't really know the story. And why don't we know the story? And so her and I started talking about it, and she really started delving into it. It was a pretty amazing story.
PR, I know that people are watching right now, and they're thinking to themselves, you know, they're hearing about the challenges and the struggles. I mean, it's a difficult journey that you had. So they're hearing that, and I'm sure that there are some people thinking, how did she go through all of that? And then 7 years later, here she is. She beat the odds. She is the salutatorian of her class. Mm-hmm. She's going to college. I read you're the first person in your family to go to college. Yeah. How did she do it? How would you respond to that question?
Well, for what drives me to where I am today was my family, because when my parents were really young, they never had a chance to education. And for all their sacrifices to bring me to where I am. Many people ask me, like, do your parents push you so much? Like, for me, like, they never pushed me. Like, they reminded me of their struggle and how important it is to have education. When you have this education, you can raise your voice and you can help other people reach other people, you know, to help them come to where you are. So for me, I know it is my responsibility to make decision for myself if I wanted to improve myself, if I wanted to go far in my life. So every day I will tell myself that I can do it, and you know, my parents sacrificed so much for me to come to where I am today, and that I can't give up. You know, it's hard. You know, it's like there's time when I feel like I want to give up, but I tell myself that I can't let that fear make decision for me, and I have so much potential in me that that I can do it. Like, you just gotta like tell yourself,
I can't let fear make the decision for me. That is a lot to come from someone who just graduated from high school, and those words alone, you have much to teach your peers and adults as well through that. I really appreciate you being here and for sharing your story and for making sure that your voice is heard and the voice of others are heard through that film as well.
Thank you for that.
Well, our viewers, you have an opportunity to see PR's film, Long Way Home, and to learn more about her story at the Rochester Teen Film Festival. The annual event is taking place on Wednesday, August 8th at 5:30 p.m. at the Little Theater. It's hard to believe it was a year ago when we first introduced you to a recreation experience solely focused on giving individuals with disabilities access to inclusive sports. Our story took us to Fairport, where we joined a mother and son sharing a special moment together for the first time, kayaking on the Erie Canal. After our story aired about Rochester Accessible Adventures, we were told that the Erie Canal Boat Company had 300 rentals by people with disabilities, with an additional 130 rentals by family and friends of those guests. So tonight, with summer now here and kayaking season in full swing, we thought we'd take you back to the canal to get a taste of what you too can experience.
Watch his foot, outside foot.
Today is a first for Jeffrey Lane. Don't be mistaken, the adventure seeker has had his share of kayaking over the years. But today, he's in for a new experience. His mom is joining him for the first time.
And you can watch what he does and do the same thing.
And Jeffrey says she's nervous.
Nice meet you. So you're going to paddle on your left side.
I had to convince you quite a bit to come and do it. Just told her that it's not as bad as she thought. And if I can do it, then she can do it.
In addition to being a little apprehensive about getting out on the water, his mom says she's also a little emotional.
Jeff is my best friend. He's been my best friend for forever. And I couldn't think of a better person to spend any time with.
I'm sorry, I'm going to get emotional.
It's something that he has done before when he was younger, but we've never been able to do it together.
We don't want to run into anybody.
The mother and son duo are joining other area families and friends participating together in this adaptive kayaking experience. Participating together being the key words.
Because of this man here in Fairport that has set up this place where handicapped people and able-bodied people can go and do things together, it's just amazing.
Tonight's event is being offered through Rochester Accessible Adventures in partnership with the Erie Canal Boat Company and other community partners.
If you'll just sign the two of you in.
RAA's mission is to ensure individuals with disabilities can access active and inclusive sports activities with family and friends.
I love the water, so any chance I can get out into the water is something I'm going to take.
A picture-perfect summer evening. 70-degree weather, and mother and son kayaking together for the first time. These are the things memories are made of.
The Erie Canal Boat Company is a community partner of Rochester Accessible Adventures, and as of this summer, the boat company has opened a second adaptive kayaking and cycling center at Wide Waters Marina in Lockport. If you're interested in getting involved in inclusive sporting activities, Rochester Accessible Adventures is now partnering with two City of Rochester R centers, Victor Parks and Recreation, the City of Canandaigua Recreation Department, SUNY Brockport, and many others. Be sure to go to rochesteraccessibleadventures.org to learn more. And that wraps up another edition of Need to Know, Rochester's news magazine. I'm your host, Helene Biendudi-Hofer. Thank you for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend here on WXXI-TV and online at WXXINews.org. I will see you next week.